money. My guest, Craig Hill, did a study of money. How often is money mentioned in the Bible?
You know, the amazing thing, Sid, is that just in the New Testament, there are 215 verses on faith, 218 verses on salvation, 2,084 verses on money. That's a fact most people don't realize. Why would the Bible be talking so much about money? You know, was Jesus after money? Is God after people's money?
There's a lot of non-Christians that would say, preach it, brother. But why have you got such a fascination over money?
Well, I have found that I really started out, Sid, in dealing with families and marriages, and I found that looking at people's marriages, money was a point of contention for so many people. And we found that there are supernatural things that happen with money that people don't realize. People just think, oh, this is just natural stuff.
Okay, give me an example. For instance, someone that has read your book, Wealth, Riches, and Money, or attended one of your seminars on money, tell me a real life example.
I was just talking to a man a couple days ago that was sharing with me a little bit of his own life, where he said, you know, all his adult life, he had just barely scraped by and just couldn't ever seem to have enough to pay his bills, and was always just, if how could I do something, you know, just to make it? He attended one of our seminars on finance and realized that not only was it his thinking that probably was blocking him, but that there were actual spiritual forces that were coming against him. He realized that there actually is a spirit of mammon. And when they prayed and broke the power of that spirit of mammon, he was telling me that within 2 months his income had doubled. And within just another few months after that, his income had tripled.
Well, what did he do? Did he just work harder?
You know, I asked him, are you doing anything different? You know, did you get a new job? He said, no, I have the same job I had before. He said, what actually happened is, he said, the job that I had, some key decisions were made. They decided to give me a raise. They decided to give me a benefits package that I didn't have before. And he said, I had been asking for years for something like that. And he said, the only thing I can determine is that there was a literal spirit that had been working through my family, he figured probably for generations, that had blocked and stopped his ability to generate finances.
I have seen so many people that no matter how much money they make, they're always behind the eight ball. That could be a spirit, is what you're saying.
I think there are two factors involved in that. One is a spirit, and the second one is forces on the inside of people that block and stop them, cause them to think wrongly and misuse money and not really realize they're doing that.
Now, you mentioned something interesting to me because I read it in your book, the notes on the book. Jesus said you can't love God or money. At least the footnotes in most Bibles say, when you look up mammon, it says money. So you can't love God and money. But you said that's not what it really means.
Well, it's that scripture, Matthew 6:24, where he said, you cannot serve God and mammon, and it uses that word mammon. And I had always been taught all my life, well, mammon is just another word for money. And as you said, in some Bibles, it actually uses that word money. And some people think, well, maybe it's an attitude of greed or something like that. I didn't know what it was until a friend of mine did a study on the origin of that word. And I was shocked to discover that what that word mammon actually was, it doesn't mean money and it doesn't mean greed or an attitude. It was actually the name of a god that was worshipped, an idolatrous god that was worshipped in the days that Yeshua walked on the earth. And that God was worshipped by Canaanite peoples, and it was a God they prayed to for prosperity.
So when you say a spirit of mammon, you literally mean a demonic spirit from this mammon.
Yeah, I found that to be true. And you know, the insidious thing about that, Sid, is people don't realize that it's there. They don't realize it's impacting their life. They just think, well, no matter how hard I work, I just can't seem to get ahead. And they don't realize, no, there's a spirit there that's actually messing up your thinking, that's actually blocking and stopping your life from functioning financially.
What are some of the things we can look for to identify if perhaps it is a spirit of mammon?
Well, what I think that spirit many times pervades all of society, and so that's why it's so insidious. But what you find is people actually measure the worth and value of other human beings in terms of money. That's a symptom right there. You hear somebody say, oh, did you realize he's worth $7 billion?
And everyone will cup their ear when they hear that.
He's not worth millions, he's worth billions. And you stop and think, now wait a minute, is that the value of a human being? A man is worth a certain amount of money? That's certainly not how God values people, but yet that's a symptom of that spirit of mammon. We find some other symptoms of mammon are bondage to debt. People, no matter how hard they work, no matter what they do, can't seem to break a bondage to debt.
And you know, this generation thinks it's always been debt society, but you pointed out this is something new.
Yeah, it really has only been a couple generations, and of course, none of us have lived longer than 100 years, by and large, to really know that. But I would bet that for any of our viewers today, if they were able to check with their great-grandparents four generations ago, most people would find that their great-grandparents carried no debt, zero debt. And yet they had a house, they had a life. How was it that they were able to live without debt? And I began thinking, what's happened over four generations? How could we have changed from the whole society having no debt to the whole society having debt? I don't think it would have even entered into someone's mind four generations ago to go to a stranger to borrow money for 30 years or 50 years to have a house. But yet, everybody thinks that way today.
Now, Craig, you have an interesting background. He studied geology, economics, and Russian. And more important than that, he has supernatural revelation on finances. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back to It's Supernatural. We now return to It's Supernatural.
Hello, Sid Roth here with Craig Hill. We're talking about a subject that most of you are thinking about. It's possessing a lot of your thoughts. It's got to do with money. And we have come in just four generations to a debt society. Four generations ago, Craig, if someone wanted a house, they didn't go to the bank and float a big $250,000 mortgage.
Right.
They just built their house.
Well, that's right. And they had help from family members. There was generational blessing four generations ago where people's grandparents and parents would help them. That's how they built a house. We have created a society where every generation stands on its own. And, you know, I was reading just a Bible verse a few years ago from Matthew chapter 5, verse 5. It said, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the land." And I had always thought, well, that applies to the sweet by and by somewhere, you know, and what does meekness mean? I found a very interesting definition of meek.
Now, when I think of meekness, that was one of the adjectives for Moses.
Yeah.
He was a meek man.
Yeah, he was a meek man. Also, Yeshua was a meek man. And I found this definition that was interesting. It's not weak, but it was having great resource or power and using very little of it. So the meek person, why was Yeshua meek? He said, I could call down myriads of angels, tens of thousands of angels. Did he ever do it? No. He used a very small percentage of the power that was actually available to him. We find in this society, it's an anti-meek society. Meaning, most people are using much more of everything than capacity that's even available. You look at how people use their time in our society. They're not meek. People are always, you know, trying to run on 150%
capacity. So what's
capacity.
The opposite of meekness?
So if meekness is having great capacity and using a percentage, the opposite is having limited capacity and using more than 100%, which is the definition of debt.
It's kind of like, I know we're not here, but we're kind of headed here.
Yep.
People are getting mortgages that are worth more than their house as their house is going down.
Right.
Some of these mortgages are called ARMs, which means they keep pace with inflation and
right.
the interest keeps going
right.
up. With your background in economics and with speaking to thousands of people about money, what do you foresee in the near future in the United States?
Well, I think we are going to see, even in this year and in the next few years, housing values come down.
We're seeing that now.
And it's happening already right now. I think the country is probably headed toward recession. People don't like to think that or to say that, but everything cycles. And so it's really foolish to believe that you're going to avoid cycles. Everything just goes up, 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 and never goes down. The problem in our society is because people are not meek. You know, when I began thinking about that, the last part of that scripture, it says two things will happen. Meek people will be blessed, and they will inherit the land. What happens to indebted people? They will not be blessed, and they will not inherit the land. And you know, I thought about our Great Depression in the 1930s here in the United States. What we saw is that a lot of people lost houses, farms, land, all kinds of things.
And then committed suicide.
Right. Now, who got those things? Well, the meek people. People that had a little bit of cash.
So what you're talking about is the wealth, the great wealth transfer that I have heard about for decades. I've heard for decades, get out of debt.
Right.
And I mean by the Spirit of God. This is a now word, get out of debt. But Craig, is it too late? Things are starting to tumble.
Now would be a critical time to begin to move. Many people may have heard even that prophetic word, get out of debt, and done nothing about it, are still in that place where they haven't moved, haven't done anything. And if you look at what happened in the 1930s, there was a huge transfer of wealth at that time from the indebted to the meek, or those that had a little bit of cash. I believe the same thing we will see in the next few years right here in the United States, a huge wealth transfer, and it will go from the indebted to the meek.
What if, I'm just kind of speculating a little bit, what if property goes down lower than even you or I are comprehending? Maybe 5 cents on the dollar.
Sure.
What would happen with someone that was out of debt, they've kept their property, has some savings, they could purchase cities.
Same thing that happened in the 1930s. There were some people that lost a lot of things, but there were some people that inherited the land, so to speak, exactly as the scripture said. So a person that has a little bit of cash and is not in debt will be able to purchase things for 10, 20, 30 cents on a dollar.
There are people listening to us. They say, Craig said, if you knew the debt that I'm in right now, I just can't do anything except maybe go bankrupt.
Yeah.
What would you say to them?
I would say that there is nobody that first of all, that person needs something supernatural to happen.
Of course.
Not just natural, but we have seen that happen so many times, time and time again. What I would really say to them, Sid, is that person gets paralyzed by focusing on what they don't have and what they can't do. A paradigm shift needs to take place.
And you're right. That's what's going on with you right now. You're paralyzed because you're just thinking all these negatives.
That's right.
But there is something supernatural. You know, my experience has been, if I will at least take a step, I'll bump into God.
Yeah, that's right. And we have found that when people that are paralyzed take a step, start looking at what they do have and what they can do, we have found an amazing thing, that if people just take 5% of their income and begin to apply it to debt, there isn't anybody that can't eradicate 100% of their debt actually naturally in 10 years.
But that's without supernatural.
That's naturally, but what you said is true. When people begin to take a small step toward God and doing natural things, we have found time and time and time again, He does supernatural things. I know one man in Mexico that was in that kind
I'll tell you what, hold that thought, and I want to find out about oil in Israel. Yes, you heard me. Oil in Israel. Don't go away. We'll be right back after this word.
We'll be right back to It's Supernatural. We now return to It's Supernatural.
Hello, Sid Roth here with Craig Hill. And Craig, before the break, you were talking about a supernatural thing that happened to one of the people that attended your seminar in Mexico.
Yeah, we had a man from Mexico come to Houston, Texas, go through a seminar. He was a cattle rancher in Mexico. And he understood that he needed something supernatural. His ranch was going under. He couldn't make the payments. He was deeply in debt. And he went to the seminar and realized just what we were talking about before the break, that God could do something. So he prayed and said, God, what do you want me to do? He very clearly heard the Spirit of God say, sell your cows. But he said, God, that's how I make a living. No, sell your cows. So he sold his cows. Well, it turned out he hit just the peak of the market, got the top price for his cows. And he said, but now I have no way to make an income. God, what do I do now? He heard the Spirit of God say, buy sheep. So he took the money and went out and bought sheep. And God gave him a supernatural idea how to breed those sheep into trophy bighorn rams that people come from the United States and pay $25,000 per head to hunt in Mexico.
That's where the supernatural kicked in.
He would have never thought in his wildest dreams had that thought, sell cows, buy sheep.
All right, speaking of hearing something, what would happen if you just turn your television on and you go to a telethon of some sort and someone says, if in the next 20 minutes there is a window of opportunity for you, everyone that gives money will get a 100-fold return. What is wrong with that picture?
I think the primary thing wrong with it is a lot of times we find people are using God and using His principles to get money. The problem with that is the goal there is, I need money. I need to do whatever I need to do to get money. And I think the truth of the matter is we don't need money. We need relationship with God. Money's a tool, not an end. So God is the end.
How did it get so, I'm going to say it for what it is, perverted?
Yeah.
I mean, I believe in sowing and reaping.
Absolutely.
I believe in giving to godly things.
Absolutely.
But there's something wrong with the motive. That's the word.
You know, I think it's that spirit of mammon that we were talking about before. Impacts people's minds and emotions and they don't realize it. People become desperate and then they begin to look at using God as a tool to get money rather than using money as a tool to serve God. And those are really opposites.
By the way, Craig, speaking of meekness, I think it is, I've met your mother and father, and I see a lot of that you got some wonderful principles. But your dad went to Israel. Mm-hmm. Tell us what happened.
Well, he actually went on a tour of Israel in 1978 or 79 and heard the audible voice of God supernaturally speak to him on top of Mount Carmel and said, come here to work. He thought, well, what does that mean? Well, his profession was that of being a petroleum geologist, so he got some maps and began to study the area, and he felt like what God was asking him to do was to drill a well in that very place where he heard the voice of God.
So did he just start a public company and raise millions of dollars and
No.
pour it down in the drains?
No, actually, there was a whole series of supernatural events that happened before that, whereby God gave him an ability to generate income through oil and gas, and actually gave him a cash flow and said, I want you to use this to drill in oil.
So he used his own money.
He used the money that God gave him. That's right. That was his money. And he felt like the Lord said, I don't want you to raise money publicly. I don't want you to take money from other investors because I want you to be able to be fully obedient to my voice and do what I'm telling you to do. If you have a bunch of investors, you're going to have to do what the investors tell you to do. You're not going to be able to do what I tell
so
you to do.
So he invested approximately how much money in his wealth?
About $7 million.
Did you get that? $7 million, and one day God spoke to him again, just as he was, according to his charts, ready to hit oil. And what did God say?
He had just another couple thousand feet to drill, and the Lord said to him, stop. Now is not the time for Israel to have oil, and I want you to stop and go no further. And that was the hardest decision, he said, in his life to make, was to obey the voice of God. Everything within him wanted to go out and find investors, find a way to continue this project. And you know, the interesting thing was there was another man that was drilling a well in Israel at a similar time, did have investors and could not stop because of the investors, I think spent over $20, $25 million and lost the whole. And never did accomplish his objective. And it was just a matter of obedience to the Lord that now is not the time.
Craig, there are people watching us right now, yeah. And their marriage is in jeopardy. They're fighting over money. They're desperate over money.
Yes.
Craig, Would you talk to them right now and
yes.
tell them there's hope?
Yeah. I want to tell you there really is hope. There is something you can do. As we said before, God is a supernatural God. And if you'll take small steps toward Him, He will take giant steps toward you. I'd like to just pray for you right now. As a matter of fact, I want you to just close your eyes and listen to my voice. Father, I pray for that woman who is listening right now saying, my husband will never change. Father, I thank you that he will change, that you will do something supernatural in his life today. Father, for the couple that is just desperate, going down the drain, about to have their house taken away, how are we going to make it? Father, I pray for a supernatural event to take place just today. And I want to ask you that are listening right now, would you just speak these words with me? Lord God.
Lord God.
I need help.
I need help.
I can't help myself.
I can't help myself. I don't want to help myself.
I give my life to you.
I give my life to you.
I want you to do what only you can do.
I want you to do what only you can do.
And I ask you to forgive my sin.
And I ask you to forgive my sin.
By the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach.
By the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach.
Jesus the Messiah.
Jesus the Messiah.
And change my life.
And change my life.
I give my life back to you.
I give my life back to you.
Amen.
Amen. Craig, briefly explain this CD. It is powerful, Sparrow Faith.
Sparrow Faith, I got from, a very simple scripture in Matthew chapter 6, verse 26, where Jesus gave his definition or his way of provision, how we are provided for. And he said, look at the birds of the air or the sparrows. And he said, they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, but yet your heavenly Father loves them and takes care of them. And does God, your Father, not love you much more than these? And I have found that most people don't have as much faith as the birds. The birds are at peace. They're at rest. They believe their Father loves them. And people are frantically running around. How am I going to make it? What am I going to do? What needs to happen? And Sparrow Faith is about getting your heart open to God the Father and allowing Him to impart that supernatural peace. I'm going to be okay because my Father loves me, and if I'll just take simple, natural steps, my Father will take supernatural steps and provision will come to me that way.
You said that things are going to get crunchy in the United States.
I think so.
How crunchy?
I think in the next few years we will see something that probably most of us have not seen in our lifetime in terms of pressure, financial pressure coming on people. If you look at really the debt culture we've created, we have a huge national debt. Do you know that we were not a debtor nation until after World War II? We've accumulated close to $9 trillion in debt in this nation.
It's that spirit of mammon you were talking
about. It's the spirit
of
mammon. So we have national debt, we have corporate debt, we have individual debt, and it really is a very simple thing. If Johnny makes $2 a week and Johnny spends $5 a week, how much will Johnny have left at the end of the month? And on a national level, an individual level, so how long can you do that? And I think it's very simple. God put a mechanism in society in the Bible called Jubilee, where you have a release of debt every 50 years. We've decided in our culture we don't need to follow these kind of antiquated biblical principles, so we have no mechanism in our culture for the release of debt. So consequently, you have only one of two choices. You keep printing money and devaluing the currency. We've seen it, you know, just in the last year. Compared to the euro, our dollar has gone from something like a dollar or a euro 15.
What's the other option?
The other option is, in order to eliminate debt, you end up with a recession and perhaps a depression where prices come down and down and down and
listen,
down.
Listen, God says, yet once more, I'm going to shake this earth, and those that are not on a foundation, they're going to fall. I want to see you on a foundation, and there is only one rock, there is only one foundation, and that rock, that foundation is Yeshua, Jesus, the King of the Jews. Make Him your Lord now.